Wild harvesting is the way that we've sourced for generations our botanicals from woodlands. And it, as the name implies, essentially is finding these products where they grow naturally and harvesting them in the wild. So technically defined, forest farming is the kind of intentional cultivation or propagation of non-timber forest products, NTFPs as they're called. There are several ways you can go about this, one of which really resembles farming in terms of planting and kind of tending, growing to harvest, harvesting and then selling. Others are related to existing plant populations, and rather than ignoring or exploiting, working to tend and propagate and grow out those plant populations with a kind of market end in mind, and you know, applying essentially these ecological principles to the agricultural proposition in the woodlands. In terms of being an alternative to wild harvesting, it offers an element of control with respect to the quality of the product. It also provides assurances related to the oversight and the tending of the stand, such that there are objectives with respect to our environmental benefits that can be achieved. And it also provides companies assurances and the kind of product lines they need to reduce adulteration and any of the kind of complications associated with large volume orders that may come from those areas. I think one of the most important factors is just the recognition writ large, or at least growing on the part of the consumer and society around the products that they purchase and where they're coming from and the impacts that they're having in terms of environmental sustainability, market equity, social justice, and other issues around their purchasing behaviors. And so there's a element of social responsibility that's at play here on the part of companies and on the part of consumers. And that can be pulled or traced back to forest farming in terms of the chain of custody that is clear and consistent in that system. I think consumers should know that there are people and there are places tied to their product. And it's not just knowing where your product comes from, but it's also understanding the context wherein that product is harvested or provided from. And that is an important issue that the discerning consumer, who does care about the environment, who does have a sense of responsibility to society, can work to grasp the real issues associated with the supply chains in the industry and help, as others along the way have worked to help, improve the overall situation so that those people and those places can be improved. In large part, where many of our woodland botanicals are harvested and sourced to the herbal products industries come from areas in Appalachia that are extremely economically depressed and distressed. And forest farming, through the possibilities of better prices, greater recognition on the part of consumers, interest on the part of companies in those raw materials, provides one avenue of a kind of natural capital and environmentally focused economic development, which to me is recognizes the true wealth in that region that has not necessarily been in the hands of the people that live there. And so it's accessing that green capital, if you will, and looking to kind of push the boundary with respect to market evolution around the intentional cultivation. And at the same time, through that, helping to protect and steward some of those plant populations in that area so that the capital is not lost in the midst of generating revenue or income, but in fact it's enhanced and developed and grown. So I think it's important to ensure that, you know, a producer base that's long been marginalized is not marginalized in the future, but lifted up at this kind of critical moment where there's a great deal of opportunity and folded into the possibilities. I think one of the biggest challenges is how to move forward together in terms of outreach and education. And by that I mean there's those that are interested in forest farming and that intentional cultivation system, which is an agroforestry practice. There are those that have been long involved in the wild harvesting trade. And neither, I think, should be segregated or separated or weighted one versus the other. But we need to think about how those systems can of production can move forward together such that the entire market benefits in terms of the traceability, confidence associated with the harvesting practices. And through all of that, we're doing right by our environment and our plants. One of the biggest challenges associated with forest farming is the time lag. These are slow-growing perennial plants primarily. And so to invest today in something that renders a saleable product in 4 to 6 years is a risky proposition or a risk proposition. And so those landowners that are interested or those others that are interested in forest farming are facing a situation where there's some uncertainty regarding next steps or the possibility of sales. So particularly at the outset, taking that step and investing with not all information known regarding where the sale may happen down the road is a difficult hurdle for those that are interested in forest farming. I think also too we're lacking some of the basic support structures that the government has put in place for our field farming. Insurance being a good example, there's not really a well-defined insurance possibility for forest farmers because for the longest time many of these non-timber forest products have been seen as recreational or things that are of little consequence or value in the market. But of course we know those markets are fairly large. They've just been for the longest time sourced through wild harvesting. Forest farming at the stages that it exists now is not going to say take over the entire supply chain. It's just not going to happen, nor do I think it should really. I think it can be balanced. I think that in that regard, the understanding of the extent to which consumers will purchase these materials and where they will purchase them, pulling back to some sort of financial planning in terms of buying forest farm products relative to some of the other sourcing is a critical step that's yet to be defined, but that could improve the opportunities for forest farmers and expand the scale of supply. Mountain Rose Herbs is a leader in this movement in terms of defining the next steps of the herbal products industry, truly. They have, with passion and practicality, taken some very important steps, and they're pushing the boundary. And I think that's critical and important. Working part and parcel with others that have been involved with the forest farming proposition, not shying away from that, but kind of diving in, has really been one of the strengths on the part of Mountain Rose Herbs' involvement. And then in doing that, putting basically money where their mouth is by actually buying these products at higher price points to demonstrate in the region where this kind of economic development could really pay off and the environmental sustainability can be part of that through the purchasing of those forest farmed, forest grown products. Mountain Rose Herbs has demonstrated that it's possible. And I think that right there is the most kind of powerful impact that the company has that had thus far in terms of the work underway in Appalachia and beyond. They are defining ways in which we can move forward, but to do that, they have to take on that risk. But that risk is being absorbed because they believe in a variety of principles associated with the business operation, providing obviously quality products to their consumers, but then looking back to the regions where those products are coming from and ensuring that we can do right by those providers of that raw material and to also do right by the plant material itself, the forests and the environment, and working in that regard to show others how we can move together toward this end. United Plant Savers brings the conservation piece of the equation to the table in a very powerful way. They have a long history of working to conserve plants throughout Appalachia and beyond, internationally even. And they have been a key driver along the way in terms of defining these next steps. They have partnered with many organizations to bring that conservation message to the overall strategy. They stick to that. They are tried and true in that regard. And that plays a very valuable and important role in the midst of this economic development proposition, because what they do is they've helped formulate a process that balances the environmental sustainability with the economic development. And in all of that, cuts through the issue of social justice. So it's the people and the plants and the products all together, and they help to ensure that that piece of the equation or that piece of the pie is front and center. There are a variety of places that people can go to gather information related to forest farming. Universities and their extension services provide fact sheets and other types of publications around the particular plants and even some of the aspects of management. There are non-governmental organizations such as United Plant Savers, Appalachian Sustainable Development, Rural Action, that have worked to put out information, to provide workshops and training. Same with the extension services, they also do that. And all of those organizations that I mentioned are tied into a coalition that focuses on promoting forest farming and working with landowners and other stewards that are interested in that particular agroforestry practice and transferring the techniques and market information that would be relevant and useful in a forest farming operation to assist those individuals as they move forward in terms of production. So you can find that information on websites. The Appalachian Beginning Forest Farmer Coalition is a outfit that was sponsored by the United States Department of Agriculture and their Beginning Farmer and Rancher Development Program. And that includes non-governmental organizations and university partners and agency partners as well. And that is a clearinghouse of sorts for this type of information. Also, training events are hosted by the coalition periodically. Over the last 3 years, we've trained 750 people in terms of forest farming practices, but we have 1,500 members in the coalition, and we have events upcoming in the future, and so we continue to kind of push along in terms of a centralized way to transfer information and make that available.